everybody, it's Mark Messier, and you're listening to Blueshirt
Autograph Show,
the number one Rangers podcast. Make sure you tune in to find out all the latest news. Let's go, Rangers.
This is an unlawful gathering.
The truth is out there.
This is the underground. This is new media. This is the underground. This is new media.
Ranger fans, remember what's the critical thinking hanger? Ranger fans, remember what's the critical thinking hanger?
And now here is the starting lineup for the New York Rangers.
This is New York Rangers hockey.
Good afternoon, Blueshirt Undergrounders. This is your Game 6 recap, wrap-up show, Sunday afternoon. My name is Jim, and as always, joined by Eddie. Eddie, how are you, sir? Here we go again.
Yeah, baby. Let's do it.
We wouldn't have it any other way.
Yeah, I mean, they go to 7 games. They're bag skating after game 2. Let's give it more. Push them more. Nothing ever comes easy in Rangerland. We all know that. That's just, I think ever since 94, they just can't really get it done in anything less than 7 games or something. Right. I don't know. No, it seems like everything's easy.
Nothing's easy. 5-2 win last night in front of a raucous Madison Square Garden.
Yeah, it was pumped. They were pumped.
It was Philip Hedel's coming out party, Eddie.
What have I said? And you have said, you perform in the playoffs. You are a champion in my eyes.
You'll walk forever within the annals of this fan base.
That's right. Everybody remember his two goal game. Hey, Michael Silvers, were you at the game last night? I know you don't live locally, but I thought I saw you in the crowd or a Michael Silvers lookalike. I got to say, folks, I mean, I'm pleased as punch. I'm just so happy, man. I mean, it's good. I mean, I don't feel. I got Danielle's going to have. Well, we're all going to be watching it. But I'm positive. And remember, I wasn't so positive coming into that game last night. You were more. And I give you the kudos.
I said it on this show the other night. I said it to anybody who listened. It never crossed my mind that they would lose last night. I was 100% convinced we were going to game 7.
You win the White Carnation, man, and I give you credit.
Just the way they play at home, the way Carolina plays on the road. And this, they had a few minutes of discontent, but this game was never in doubt. Sorry, this was Rangers game from mostly beginning to end. Igor was in control, my friend.
Yes, that's definitely. I didn't like the amount of time that it took for Brady Shea to just throw one at the net after the Heatles' first goal. That I had a problem with. But other than that, I don't think it was in doubt. I was much more comfortable in this game than I've been. So I'm all about it.
So I'm pumped. I think the Rangers got a good chance of winning. Antti Raanta did not look good. He got pulled in the game. They brought in some other Russian kook.
Sean, he's so tired, Sean. Sean. That's my new friend. Sean. All of a sudden, he's tired. He wasn't tired in game five, but he's tired in game six.
Right.
Get out of here.
You're making excuses.
He's a fucking Carolina apologist disguised as ESPN. He's
a 30-year-old. I mean, maybe there is a factor that he doesn't play regularly. Maybe. But I remember coming into this series. Oh, what a story. Antti Raanta. Well, look at his goals against and his save percentage.
Right.
Oh, what a miracle for a guy who came in for Frederick Anderson. What a wonderful name. Gushing.
Right. Ray Ferraro is embarrassing. He's embarrassing himself.
I think he has a bet. I think all these guys have bets.
Think he's got money down?
Bet.
you think he placed a bet with Janet Jones or Rick Tockett?
Maybe. You might get one of those FanDuel, DraftKings, whatever.
Got a little something running on the side there.
I think so. All right, because it's just too much.
He's coaching them practically.
Yes.
I mean, he's coaching them. What Carolina needs to do is get this line going, and then push more in this. I'm like, just stop fucking coaching. Shut up. He's embarrassing. I'm sorry. I mean, he's worse than Pierre.
Pierre. But yeah, come on, let's just be realistic. We're gonna get annoyed by the same voices over and over again. I mean, that's the nature of our fan base. It's just
we don't want to hear
bad things. We don't hear good things. We think they're a jinx. I mean,
again, Sean McDonough, he doesn't bother me.
He bothers me now.
He completely blew the Carolina goal call last night. I don't know what he was doing at the time. I don't know if I don't know if he was ordering Grubhub. I don't know what he was doing, but he completely missed that call.
What, he got a cappuccino? I'll tell you why he bothers me.
Go ahead.
He keeps referring to the Pittsburgh series with the Rangers. Like, he constantly goes back to that. And it's like, dude, that's, six games now removed. I don't want to hear how Shesterkin, we got pulled from two games. I don't want to hear about, the Rangers. He keeps going back to that. Talk about the game and the momentum. It's almost like, I don't know. I do see Ferraro. It definitely leans a little bit. Well, I know you probably disagree with me, but he leans a little bit. Carolina, so you probably say a lot. I think he's got a bet.
I think
all these guys have bets.
Playing that fantasy hockey, they got that couple going. That stupid thing, they got money riding on it.
Yeah, I don't know what they got going on this. I also think that the rest of the league thinks the Rangers are frauds.
I just think it's funny that if you asked most people before this series what they thought of Ray Ferraro, everybody kind of liked him, and everybody fucking hates him. Can't stand this guy. Just from what I'm reading, I mean, he has just completely turned heel on the Ranger fan base.
Oh yeah, most of the Ranger fan base can't stand.
I think if there's two guys the Ranger fan base will never invite to dinner, it's Ray Ferraro and Tony D'Angelo at this point.
Oh, Tony D is not making a good case for himself, Sam. I mean, Sean. I mean, he is.
Oh, Sean, look. He came into this series. He's been getting booed by the Garden. Now he's embraced it. I mean, I'm not on his side anymore.
He's a punk.
But he's embraced it. He's playing the heel.
And he stinks.
He's the heel. Well,
he's coughing the puck up at the Garden.
He hasn't been good at all. He hasn't been good at all. And he's always on the ice. I swear to God, this guy's getting 45 minutes of ice time.
Power play. He plays like a minute 30. And that power play is horrible.
I couldn't be happier about that, Sam. Let's talk about the goods here, Sam. Yeah. Filipino, Mika Zibanejad, Tyler Mott.
Oh, that was a bad
goal. Nobody knew who this guy was. Now he's thinking, we got to have him. Nobody knew. Chris Drury didn't know anything about this guy. And now we got to have him, Eddie. We got to have him.
Listen,
this is the key to our long-term success, Eddie.
No. Well, the long-term success, maybe. I think the return of Barkley Goodrow.
How about Barkley Goodrow?
Oh, that's my man. Green. That's my boy.
Coming out of nowhere, the Garden went batshit when he came on the ice last night,
like
I heard.
Messier Sam. Coming like a Willis Reed moment.
It was Willis Reed.
I love that guy.
Yes, I mean...
He just brings an edge, and he's got the experience. And
you know what I love? You know what I like about him? He reminds me of Brett Favre in the way that he never stops smiling. He just looks like he's having so much fun, no matter what's going on. He just looks like he's having a blast on the ice. But he's fun to watch, and he made a difference, Sam. He made a difference.
I think he's going to make a difference in Game 7 too.
I hope so. I have some thoughts on Game 7, which we'll get to in a couple minutes.
But let me again, I'm not going to do mea culpa on Filipino. I'm not. I saw a little people referring to me and the whole thing.
Well, that's I've said that before. The minute we take a player to task, we are forever attached to that player.
Yes, like but you know what? I don't. At the time that I was evaluating him, that's what I saw.
You now exist in the zeitgeist next to Filipino. I mean, that's just how
I'm attached to him for life.
Right. Brian Boyle will forever be my sidekick, and Filipino is fast becoming yours.
Listen.
Every time Brian Boyle does anything in this league, look at Jim. Did you see what Brian Boyle did? Oh, Jim. Oh, can't wait to hear what Jim has to say. Filipino is your Brian Boyle.
Well, it's so funny because every time I say something bad about a player, he fucking shoves it up my ass.
Fine. Take it.
I should just curse everybody now. Yeah, really. Like, Filipino, I think he missed a chance previous to that first goal. I go, this fucking guy sucks. Get him off the team. Then he scores.
So they had the 2-on-1, and
yes.
He missed. And yes. Then they had another 2-on-1 on the same shift.
Right. Now, how many times did you see that? Two 2-on-1s on a same shift? So I'm all, you know, listen, Philip, and then he scored on a beautiful shot was it the first goal or the second goal? It's a real nice shot up top. I don't remember if it was the first or second.
I believe that was the first goal. Well, we could look at him if you want.
Yeah, let's look at him. I'll break down Filipino and tell you.
Hang on. I got a couple other things to show. Let me just pull it. I had it and then I accidentally closed the tab. Hang on a second.
Rangers. Jen informing me that the Empire State Building trolled them again.
Oh, did they?
That's what she said.
I didn't see that. I did not see that.
Well, I will tell you that Alec Idle is talking about Hervé Villages to Mr. Rourke. Mr. Rourke hated Hervé Villages. Hervé was asking for like big money and his own trailer. He's like, listen. Tattoo, you're only a gimmick. I'm Mr. O'Rourke.
Tattoo.
I was Khan, for Christ's sake.
All right, here's the first Heedle goal. So we're going to look at this.
They were spread apart looking for energy for the other lines, and now they want them back. They got another 2-on-1. Here's Heedle again, and he scores!
A lot of room on that.
Filipino makes it 3-0 Rangers.
I don't see no suits anymore.
And Heedle keeps.
Yeah, I like that. Picks right over the top corner. Yeah,
really and it's got his third goal of the playoffs, like a 3-0 Ranger lead.
Ranger!
Oh, that's the recap. We don't want that. Hold on. Here's the second goal.
Popping bottles, that's right.
Emily, thank you. Here's pressure again from the kid line. Another goal on a backhand. Philip Heedle again.
Here's pressure for an offside
from the kid line. Another goal on a backhand. Philip Heedle again.
Look at that crowd, Sam.
Pushing the 22-year-old to be a little more assertive. Look at a play. play he makes on Brendan Smith. The reverse hit, the shoulder, keeps Smith off balance.
Now couldn't believe he won a puck battle. Corner,
and then he shovels it backhander. It's perfect.
That's a nice shot, though, if you think about it.
Oh, yeah, that's beautiful. Shot.
Yeah, that's a beautiful backhand.
Fantastic. We might as well look at Panarin's goal, as long as we're here.
Oh, God, that was crappy.
12 and a half to go, third period, 4-2 Rangers. Panarin shot it over the net.
Look how much room is on the net when he scores.
Strong played it in
for one side.
Kreider. Room in the circle. Kreider out in front for Panarin. Panarin scores!
Just kept
beautiful
on the ice.
Wrister inside the left post.
Danielle, were you going crazy? I mean, this is... That place looks electric, man. That I don't see no suits there. Everybody says our place is so quiet. I don't think so. That place was rocking.
Eddie is framing his Hedo rookie card.
You know how many rookie cards I got of that guy in different brands? Probably like 12, 13.
He's maturing, Sam. He's starting to look more like a man instead of like a 14-year-old kid.
It's true. Listen, I'm ecstatic. Filipino, you're forever in Ranger lore now. I will not be calling for your dismissal, at least for a couple years. You get like 2 years of...
Igor Shesterkin, the first goalie with two assists and a penalty in the same game since?
Oh, I heard this. Was it Tom Barrasso?
Tom Barrasso.
Yes.
Very good, sir.
Listen, Shesterkin is the only reason. I mean, let's face it. I mean, not the only reason, but he is part of the Rangers winning formula. He has to make 35 saves a game. He almost got 40, I think, right?
What he's here for. That's what they pay him for.
Yeah, but eventually you're going to get burnt out, dude. You cannot have this guy subjected.
Why?
What?
July,
get it worked out. And it was guys. A couple guys are talking about his penalty. The Rangers were gassed for some reason. They can't get players off the ice for 2 minutes and 40 seconds. I mean, people were just there. Was three guys, I think, and he took that interference penalty, which was smart. I thought.
Do you think he took it on purpose? I think he took it. I almost think he took it on purpose.
I think he did.
I think he knew they could stop their power play, and I think he knew the team was gassed and needed a break. It was too deliberate the way he just stepped out of the net and threw a hit at was it Jarvis, I think, or something?
Yeah.
Hey, as long as you can back it up, it's a smart play. If you give up the goal there, then you're an idiot.
I agree with everybody pretty much thinks it that he did it intentionally, and it was a smart play because first of all, the power play for Carolina is struggling, to say the least. Get the change, man. Because that was gonna lead to a goal, man. If that puck that situation had it just had horror all over it that this is going to end. I didn't quake in my boots as much as previous games in this game. Like you said, I felt like they had control of it. The key for them is they've got to get the lead.
Right.
Because they play that man-to-man. The Rangers still haven't even tried to solve that. It just, we go out there and play hard and play our game and we'll win the game. I like our room. So that's basically the strategy of Gerard Gallant. But when you get out to a lead, they can't play that man to man. They've got to take chances. They're getting frustrated with Shesterkin and their power play isn't working. So there's only a few ways. I thought that this is what... If I can just finish this thought, the reason I felt the Rangers might be teetering, because I keep waiting for Carolina to show me the team that they were, that won them the conference. But they haven't emerged, and I keep waiting for that. Maybe they're the fraud.
Maybe.
Granted,
maybe they're neutralized a little bit by what the Rangers are doing. Maybe the Boston series took something out of them. I don't know.
I think also, you know, you got to take it. If Frederik Andersen is in this series, which he's not, so it doesn't, well, we don't know. Maybe he'll show up as some kind of savior, again, like a Willis Reed move. But they don't look the way they looked in the regular season. They just don't. And good.
Right. Good.
I want you to fail. I don't want to see the team that, beat us out. I like that one. No shorthanded goals in game seven, and the Rangers will win. Also, they got to improve the shots. I'm going back to the shots. Got to get 30 shots on net at least in this next in game seven. I think they're going to put goals up.
25 last night.
What do they have?
25.
It's still, that is.
Two goals on the first seven shots. But you can't expect that every night.
I know, but they got to. We got to generate more shots. Got to generate more shots. And I think the key is to, Rangers got to come out, get the lead. I know the one goal lead is very precarious. But when the Rangers get a two goal lead, I get very, okay. And let's face it, we got Shesterkin. It's playing fucking crazy.
Right.
And I see the frustration is starting to settle in with Carolina. I mean, they're taking liberties after the whistle. And pretty much the Rangers have stayed away from any of the nonsense.
For the most part. I mean,
it's going to be crazy, Rod, I think, game seven. But I'm pretty positive now. I think it's time for the dam to break for Carolina's home thing.
Somebody's going to beat them sooner or later at home. It might as well be us, right?
Oh, we beat them with Georgiev. All right, we got outshot 60 to 15 or whatever we did, but we did beat them. Yeah, D'Angelo, he takes stupid penalties.
And he makes stupid mistakes. What did we say after game two or game three? That team has Brendan Smith, Tony D'Angelo, and Brady Shea on their defense. We know better. We know they can be beat. We know they can be had. We know better. Nobody knows better than we do. Those three guys can be beat. They have weaknesses.
Have we heard from Brendan Smith?
Stevens and Brian Leetch and Chelios back there. We know these guys.
Right.
Get after them.
So
we know better. We saw it last night. Tony D'Angelo makes a lot of mistakes.
He really played bad.
Brendan Smith makes mistakes. Brady Shea is still a lunkhead. I don't care if he scored a goal last night. He's a lunkhead. He always was.
He just throws it toward the goal and it went in. I mean, that's kind of his MO, which is kind of a plus, is that he can get that puck through to the net. But we know defensively these guys are liabilities. Tony D'Angelo is a big-time liability. He's great offense.
Right.
But he's never going to do anything in this. I'm not saying that. I'll retract that statement. But, Now.
And for everybody that says, I want Reeves to fight Tony D'Angelo is never going to fight.
Never.
Never going to happen.
Never, ever.
Never. Jesper Fast would fight Ryan Reeves before Tony D'Angelo would. And Jesper Fast is 113 pounds.
Oh, my God. Keandre Miller just like pushed him down? It was just like not even a full push. It was just like, and Foss just went down line on the ice.
It's just he's not going to fight him. Tony D'Angelo has referee balls. He's tough when the referee's in between him and the player he's jawing at. That's it. He's like Brian Boyle. Nobody was tougher with a referee in front of him than Brian Boyle. Nobody.
I agree. I mean, Fox is light years better than TDA. I mean,
I don't think anybody on that team wants to fight Reeves. Reeves was looking at anybody at the end of that game. Nobody wants it. Nobody wants a piece of him.
And that stupid linesman getting in the way of them fighting. Come on. Just let the let Let Revo go. Finally. Go. I think he had three hits last night and a series high. But yeah, I agree with Facebook user. I can't see your name there. But the person who made the lab, I said,
that's Peter Fox.
Oh, Peter Fox. I'd settle for a crush open ice hit on D'Angelo. I'm just worried about winning the game. I don't care about the comeuppance, this and that. Win the game, you know, face Tampa. You know, that's what I want. I'm not going to be, I'll be disappointed if they manage to lose, but I think I'm pretty optimistic if they could just get some more shots on the net. Their goalies stink. Rotta gave up some horrible goals.
He did. And that backup that they thought was going to change the game and change the, he wasn't.
Nah, it didn't really work.
Great. He was 3-0 in the regular season. Good for him. So was Mackenzie Skapski one time.
Yes. There's Rock. Rock, were you at the game and did you sell your tickets again?
What's up, Rock?
Rock is constantly selling his tickets. What the hell did you get season tickets for if you couldn't enjoy that game? You better have been there, my friend. So, man, I'm hopeful. Maybe it's a fool's errand. I don't know. what else am I going to do?
I think tomorrow night, and I said this to Jen this morning, and then I read it in Arthur Staples' column in The Athletic today. I think tomorrow night you throw caution to the wind. He sold his tickets. Children change your life.
That's why you get a wife. She minds the kids. You go to the game. That's how it works.
I think tomorrow night, Eddie, I think they just got to turn it loose. They got to come at Carolina. They got to bring everybody at Carolina. None of this laying back or letting Carolina dictate the game. If Igor has to make 45, 50 saves, and that's what he's there for. He's certainly capable of it. Stay out of his way. Keep his crease clear. Let him see the puck and go after Carolina. You can't just sit back tomorrow night. If you're going to sit back and let Carolina do what they did in game five, then you might as well have not even won game six. You might as well just mailed it in. Brought your golf clubs right out on the ice, did another blue shirts off our back on the table, and called it a day. So what's the point of going all the way down there if you're not going to play in another game? Steve Schaefer's going to be in the crowd. Adam Bartolo's going to be in the crowd.
Oh, Steve Schaefer's going to be there?
Steve Schaefer's going to the game.
The one who said the Rangers had no chance against Carolina. You're fooling yourself. And
I'll let you talk to him about it. He's a big – he's a lot bigger than you and I.
Oh, I know. I'm only kidding, Steve. He honked at me and – when I was down there, he saw me leaving the building when I was down there in the season. Now, Steve's a great guy, man. I mean, he knows his hockey, too. But he was painting a real bleak picture. And I was just kind of just like trying to say, like, listen, anything can happen. You know, you don't know. The playoffs are full of upsets and things that don't figure.
But I just think that what they've done, for the most part, the three games in Carolina hasn't worked. But Igor is the X factor. He's kept him in every game. Every game has been, you know, I think game five until there was about 6-7 minutes left. They've all been one goal games. A one goal game, anything can happen. You're just a bounce away. You're just a guy falling down. You're just a bounce, a bad puck, anything. Line referee hits, puck hits a referee, bounces to the right guy. Anything can happen. Igor's keeping him in these games. Turn it loose. If he has to make 55 saves tomorrow night, so be it. I don't care.
See, I'm not going that crazy.
I don't care. The man made 79 saves in game one against Pittsburgh. He is fully capable. He is not going to, you know, it doesn't bother him to make 50 saves. It doesn't. Turn him loose. Got to leave it all on the ice tomorrow night. We cannot just sit back and let Carolina
sound
all night long.
I'm just saying, like, if the Rangers get up 2-0, I don't want to see them, we got to just go full throttle and hope that
gas, no brakes tomorrow night.
Got to play smart, Sam.
No, Joe, the playing smart's got to – playing smart is what, you know, got us
lucky.
They've scored, what, one goal in Carolina? Two goals?
Really?
Didn't they get it right? Am I wrong? Two goals? Hold on, Sam. I'm checking downstairs in the truck with Chris Ebert. One goal in game one, which was an overtime game. No goals in game two. One goal in game five. That's two goals, Sam.
Oh, boy.
Being smart ain't working. It's time to get a little retarded. It's time to get a little mentally irregular, as Rocky would say. Safe as death.
Right. You know who said that safe as death? John Tortorella. And then he made it just death.
That it was death.
We were in our own zone the whole time.
It's time to turn them loose. I keep quoting Rocky all day long. There is no tomorrow, Rock. There is no tomorrow.
No, I agree. I mean, now you kind of
rather go down swinging than go down backpedaling and getting forechecked to death.
Well, they got off. They got to get
through nothing.
They got to get to a good start. That's how they win, you know. And you know, I feel like the Rangers are in their heads a little bit. They keep getting a chance to close it out, and they can't do it. They had to think, well, you know, we have a good chance here. We're up 3-2, and they couldn't get it done. They couldn't unleash what they had done in the regular season, Carolina. And I think the return of Goodrow, the Rangers are healthy now, if you really think about it.
For the most part,
they had they're getting players back. Like, you know, Martin,
we don't know how hurt Panarin is. We don't know how hurt Lindgren is, but they're playing.
You know, there's
what's better? Artemi Panarin at 50% or 60% or Johnny Brodzinski at 100%. I'll still take my chances with Artemi Panarin.
They're still contributing. I mean, you know, right. Panarin not to the greatest. I don't know what's going on with Chris Kreider. I mean, I don't want us to talk about bad things, but
one shot on goal last night again.
I mean, this
guy's not good enough.
I mean, he's invisible. I don't even know what he's doing.
He's pumping the brakes a little bit on everybody handing him that captaincy.
Yeah, well, listen, I in the playoffs, like, so you see a guy like Hedl. I mean, you could say Kindline, Schmidline. Carolina must be going, their fans are, Hedl. I thought this guy had 8 goals in the regular season, is lighting it up against us.
Right.
So there's unexpected heroes to pick up for some of you guys key on. I'm sure Carolina fans are asking themselves, where is this guy? Where is that guy?
Right.
On their teams. But, you know, Kreider didn't make a play. What game was that where he kicked the puck?
That was game 4.
Yeah. That was a great play. I mean, that was a heads-up play.
Absolutely. So that whole play started with him kicking the puck and keeping it deep. Absolutely.
I would say the kid line has done pretty good, but Kako, he'll probably get 2 tomorrow if I curse him. But,
you know, again, if this series doesn't end the way we want it to, you're going to look at the guys that, you know, really came up short, because you're only, you know, I mean, this series has been so tight. 2 goals, 3 goals could make the whole difference in this series.
Right.
So you're going to look at the guys that could have scored, that should be scoring those 2-3 goals, and that's, you know, that's what you need.
Kako scores in game 2. Maybe we're not even here. You know, you got to move on. I mean, you know, I'm
entirely
not going to.
Possible. Ifs and buts.
Ifs and buts.
Ifs and buts. Know.
And Sean's right. You look at Darren Helm. Some guys make their whole living in the playoffs.
Now, since we've shifted to talk about game 7, mm-hmm. I don't know if you've heard about this yet.
Uh-oh.
The Rangers are having a viewing party for game 7. Have you heard about this?
No, I haven't heard.
Joe, you're going to love this, Joe.
Are they going to bring out the whole entire alumni for this?
Oh, well, I'm sure. Check this shit out.
Okay.
Oh, hold on. Shit, there we go. So let me. My mouse is giving me trouble here. Come on, stupid thing. There we go. It's game 7, and we need New York City louder than ever. This is why we are transforming the Overlook at Woolman Rink in Central Park into an outdoor viewing party. Join us for alumni appearances, fan giveaways, music, and more. The party is free to attend, but capacity will be limited. Be sure to register for the attendee list and arrive early. Admission will be granted on a first-come, first-served basis. Note, we are required by NYC Parks to mute the sound after 10 p.m. Ah! Download the Rangers app ahead of time so you can listen to the ESPN radio feed. So we need New York louder than ever, but we're going to turn the sound off at 10 o'clock.
Sound off at 10.
10 o'clock on a Monday, on a holiday night. We're going to turn the sound off. 10 o'clock. Turn on the radio feed, which is 10 time zones behind the live game action.
Right. What a shit show.
Why does this organization just continually miss the mark on things like this?
This is why, like...
Why have it there if you have to turn the sound off at 10 o'clock? Have it at the Garden.
Right.
Have it at UBS. There's nothing going on there.
Doing anything over there.
Have it at Barclays. Nothing going on over there.
Right.
Have it in the middle of Times Square.
This sounds like something the Islanders would pull.
Right.
This is very rank.
I mean, why do they just continue? It just seems like they do everything half-ass.
But say the Rangers win Game 7, which they will, and then it's going to be after 10 o'clock because the game starts at 8, right?
Game's at 8.
What, are they tell everybody not to cheer?
The game ends at 10:30.
I love how you're
that,
right.
You know, if it's a normal pace game, 10:30, 10:40, something like that.
Right.
There'll be nothing but the sound of the crank pipes.
You know what?
And the guy's getting blowjobs in the bushes.
I like when you brought up, we get New York to be louder than ever, but not after 10 o'clock.
Right, up until 10 o'clock. All of a sudden, the city that never sleeps goes to bed at 10 o'clock.
The parks, Joe. Oh, the parks.
I mean, people go to the movies at like 11:30 at night in New York City. And we're gonna shut the game off at 10 o'clock?
Well, they're going to show the game, but the audio, right?
Same thing. I mean, come on. Listen to the radio. So you're going to have 90 through 200 people all playing the game on their phones at a different sync because, you know, depending right. on your signal, depending on how fast your phone is. So, you know, you're going to hear a call like 37 times as it makes its way from phone to phone. Dumb. Just dumb. Come on.
Just a total dumb idea. Oh, my God.
Why? I mean, I just don't understand why they continually just miss the mark on shit sometimes. Sometimes they get stuff dead on, and another time, it's like they blow the easy ones.
They blow the layups.
They blow the layups.
Yeah.
I mean, you know.
It's so stupid.
I hope to God for those people that are going there that, you know, the Rangers come out and score 7 goals in the first by 10 o'clock.
So he was screaming out.
Man, how do you listen? How do you watch an entire period on mute with 10,000 people? I mean, I don't know how many people they're allowing in this thing.
I mean, if the game started at 6 o'clock, then it makes sense.
Then you got no problem.
8 o'clock. Oh, this is so dopey. Everyone should be fired. That's associated with this.
And okay, I'm going to put some of the blame on the Rangers, and that's fine. But the New York City Parks Department, we can't make an exemption for the Rangers.
Yeah, really? Come on.
They've been around for 100 years. Why?
Will they lose customers?
And that rink is like in the middle of Central Park. Is it going to be that loud? Are we really going to disturb the people on Central Park West?
This is so stupid. Like, doesn't James Dolan own New York? Can't he just bribe these guys?
I mean, they're the third oldest franchise in New York City. And they're only a year behind the Giants.
Like, if Kanye West was doing it, or Jay-Z, they'd wave this 10 o'clock thing.
Did they make Simon and Garfunkel go mute at 10 o'clock? Did they have that concert?
Bridge over.
Right.
I'm going to show up there with my transistor
radio.
They
did the sound of silence, and then at 10 o'clock, they really went silent.
Uh,
Are they going to stop the cars from honking their horns on Fifth Avenue at 10 o'clock today?
No. It's so stupid.
Fuck the rich people. Fuck them.
People on Fifth Avenue will cause a stink.
Then do it at Times Square. Do it at Times Square.
Just do it anywhere. But I hope it rains so nobody shows up. And
Fred Anderson standing out there in the rain selling hot dogs.
The Rangers can't pay this $200 fine they're going to get. Oh, boy. I don't know. I don't know. It's just a stupid idea. It just, again, you're right, Jim. You're hitting all cylinders today.
Do it at Times Square. Clear out the dirty Elmos and the disgusting Mickey Mouses. And, you know,
probably can't afford that. They're probably, Central Park, we could use this. Yeah, can you use the Felt Forum or whatever they got going down there? The Hulu Center, whatever they call that place.
The Felt Forum.
I mean, don't they have a small place in there? That thing's had a lot of names.
The Paramount Theater, the Hulu Theater.
You know, they change it every week.
They've had a lot of names.
The Nokia Theater. Wasn't it the Nokia Theater at one point?
Might have been. Wasn't it MSG Live? Wasn't it called that at one point?
I have no idea.
It's had a lot of names.
But
I don't know. I just feel like New York City, there's like a million places we could do things. Why do you have to do it someplace where we got to shut the sound off on the game at 10 o'clock?
I just think they don't know what a sports fan is. Like, we need the audio, you morons.
Right.
First of all, half our bit is to make fun of the announcers when we're watching the game. You taking that away from us for the third period?
Do it at Grand Central. I like that idea.
Grand Central Station?
Sure. Why not? You got that big open cavernous terminal there.
You,
there.
You understand there's a business going on.
Welcome.
Apparently, they sleep at the 10 o'clock at the parks.
Right.
Oh, boy.
I don't know.
Well, thank God. I can go to my barbecue today and complain about this. Thanks for this news.
I just feel like they sit around in this organization and they try and come up with great ideas, and then they try and think of the worst possible way to go about it.
Right. I don't know. It's the stupidest thing ever. One of the stupidest things I've heard in recent memory.
Everybody's going to be sitting there like it's a baseball game at Shea Stadium in 1963 with their transistor with their little earbud in. Listening to Lindsey Nelson.
You can hear, and he scores. And then 30 seconds later, and he scores. 3 seconds right. later. Yay! Yay! that's true. I like what Kim says. They go to sign language in the third period.
Dustin said he's going to turn the audio off in his house at 7 p.m. in solidarity. With a lame fist.
That's right, buddy. That's right.
Viewing party lives matter.
That's true.
The commentary switches to sign language. I like that.
Do you know who the alumni is going to be there?
I'm sure it's the same.
Brian Mullen,
Stefan Matteau, Tom Laidlaw's a maybe. You know, same.
Glenn Anderson. Going to wear his Instigator shirt?
If Glenn Anderson's not calling bingo somewhere tomorrow night, he'll be there.
Is Kotze going to wear his Instigator
shirt? You know what we should do? We should go live at 10 o'clock tomorrow night.
And call the game?
And call the game.
I don't live really. On YouTube. No, I am not going to do that. I'll be probably PR engrossed in this game. Totally.
I'll be on the patio.
Yes.
6-1.
You going to wear your Kotze Instigator shirt?
Negative.
I'm wearing it. If the Rangers win, I'm making a Kotze Instigator shirt. And I'm going to get a fucking Wolverine hair piece.
I just watched Logan yesterday. Kotze was really good in that.
I like Logan. I like all those X-Men movies. But
yeah, Logan was pretty good.
So, Is that Peter Fox again with Cyrus? Can you dig it? Well, the Warriors. You guys are cracking me up.
Paulie D.
By the way, Paulie, I never realized Paulie looks a lot like Rod Brindamore.
He does. Yeah, I noticed. He
looks a lot like Rod Brindamore.
Maybe one of you guys with the art, what do they call that?
The Photoshop?
The Photoshop could put a little gray thing on Paulie.
Or put an Instigator shirt on Rod Brindamore.
Yeah, that's even better. Somebody get on that. Sean, you're great at that. Wow.
I'll get Joe working on it.
Okay. I love it. I love what I saw. And you know, another thing, Jim, the Rangers can get 4 or 5 goals. I don't think Carolina has that in them. They can't get 4 or 5 against us. So we get 3. We got the game, I think. So maybe you're right. First one to 3, first one to 2, we probably win. And you're also balls on with as far as, hey, whatever they're trying to do in Carolina hasn't worked. So they got to try something different.
I just think they got to come at them. They've let Carol, you know, there's this, you know, obviously there's a little intimidation factor going on with that building. I mean, Carolina is so good in that building. The crowd is loud. I get all that, but you got to get past it. And you can't sit back and let Carolina dictate play tomorrow night, or else it's going to be another 1-0, 2-1 loss. Just another boring, you know, horrible, flaccid way to go out of the game.
They're not going out that way. I think they...
And Matt, it's funny you mentioned that, because last night the Western Conference Finals starts... Empire State Building trolling the Carolina Hurricanes again. The Eastern Conference Finals are scheduled to start Wednesday night. So if they stick to the every other night schedule, it'll be game 1 Wednesday, game 2 Friday, game 3 Sunday, game 4 Tuesday, game 5 Thursday, game 6 would be next Saturday. So that Billy Joel concert on June 10th, Friday night, will not be affected, which is very important to me. Because I bought the tickets in November.
Oh, okay. Okay. So, I want to give credit. Now, you guys who are at the game, men, ladies. Hey, Mike, how are you?
Hey, Mike.
I love this singer. He's the new Amaranthi, this baritone guy. What's his name?
Don Brancy. Oh, he's fantastic.
I want this guy forever. Put a blue coat on him and call him Amaranthi all over again.
I love the he comes out with the Ranger scarf and the white tie. I mean, this guy is like, he's like the maestro from Seinfeld. Oh, he's fantastic. Fantastic.
Keep him.
Full time.
Find another fire department broad or whatever.
No, I like her. I like her.
I like her.
A couple of times a year when we do something for the police. But, her.
That's fine. But the playoffs, you got this guy is like Amaranthi.
Right. Well, absolutely. This guy should be, this guy should be doing 20-30 home games a year at all the playoff home games.
What's this guy's name? King Clancy?
John Brancy.
King Clancy?
King Clancy. John Brancy.
Love this guy.
Oh, he's fantastic. I love it. I love his voice. I love his. He's just got that look about him. You know, he's like the maestro from Seinfeld.
Right, yeah, and he's doing these.
With the hand.
Commanding.
Thing. You know, he's got it.
He's commanding the rain, the hockey gods to come down.
Oh. What do you got against Billy Joel there, Danielle? Rocco said, have Billy Joel sing the anthem. He sang the anthem at Ranger games.
Back in the 70s, he has.
Yeah, what do you got against Mr. Joel there?
Well, come on. He's not,
he's got a banner at MSG.
That's true. Billy Joel's good, but, I've had enough. I haven't seen enough.
Oh, Brancy's fantastic. I love his whole look. The bald head. He's got the scarf and the white tie. I mean, who wears white ties anymore? It's fantastic.
I have to say, I hope we see more of Mr. Brancy in the next round.
I'd like to see Mr. Brancy at least four more times for four more home games.
That's right. So you know what I think is neat?
What's going on at the Garden now in these home games with Igor?
With the shutting up the sound?
I've never seen this before. We didn't see this even with Hank. Maybe once in a while, but you know, even when Igor gives up a bad goal, the crowd starts chanting his name. Yeah. It's like they're bringing him right back up. And I don't know if that's maybe because he struggled a little bit in Pittsburgh with the crowd and the chanting, but that's pretty remarkable. I mean, that's not something you see a lot of, especially in New York.
Yeah, in New York, forget it. This is a load for him. And I wanted to ask you about this because I do remember Hank in his heyday, but I don't remember this kind of love for Hank. There was love. You know what I'm saying? But these people are behind him even when he gives up a stinker. They want to help him.
Right. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know what it is. I mean, you know, I said before that I feel like Ranger fans have a love affair with their goaltenders that I don't know if other teams have. I mean, it goes back to, you know, Jockeman in the 70s. And granted, you know, again, we've had 60 years of pretty solid goaltending, which most teams aren't lucky enough to have either. But yeah, there's something, you know, I don't know what it is, but there's something going on with this crowd with Igor that they've really taken to this guy.
Yeah, not.
And they want to, you know, even after he gives up a stinker, they're chanting his name.
It's like they're very protective of him. They don't want him to get rattled. They know what he...
And I really think it's got a lot to do with what went on in Pittsburgh. I really do.
Yeah.
I think they saw that maybe, you know, it affected him a little bit. It took him out of his game, and they just want to make sure that, you know, well, we love you until you give up three goals.
Right.
Then we'll bail on you.
No, I agree with you. Danielle, you're there. You see it. I know, you know, it's a next level love. Now, I don't know how long it's going to last, but right now it's, you know, and they also know that the game really rests on him. I mean,
that's nothing new.
Yeah, but, you know, if he gives up four goals, they're not winning, you know, in most cases. But no, I know what you're saying. I know what you're saying, Jim. I mean, it's
almost like the fans collectively worry about this guy's psyche in a way I've never seen with a New York athlete before.
Well, because they've
never seen that.
He's going to win the Vezina, all right? He's not going to win the Hart. We can all agree on that. That's not happening.
I don't think so.
No.
I'd be very surprised if he wins the Hart.
So the only thing for him to conquer, you know, and so far he's only played, what, 2-3 years, is the playoffs. And I think Ranger fans really want to see him do well in the playoffs, because not just because the Rangers' fate hinges on it, but also because they really have fallen in love with this guy. And, you know, he's a happy-go-lucky guy. He's got the hairband, the headband. He seems like a really lighthearted spirit. He's not like Hank with his humongous ego and his hair and all this and all that stuff. I don't know. Maybe, you know, Rollo, a.k.a. Alec Idle, a.k.a., makes a good point. You know, the home crowd isn't like it was in the 70s and 80s, where it was like... When was the last Ranger they booed?
While he was a Ranger?
Yeah, like he was playing.
Redden.
Did they boo Dick Rash?
Redden. So Redden definitely got booed. I don't remember about Nash.
I don't think Nash got booed. I mean, I'm trying to think. It is
Redden got booed.
Yeah, Redden got booed.
Every time he touched the puck, he was getting booed towards the end.
Yeah. So it's been a while since the Rangers.
Dan Boyle?
You hated Dan Boyle. And you, well, as well, you should.
As well, I should. That was a bad signing. He didn't want to be here. Ridiculous. I fucking hate him. Miserable. Right,
What's Jen talking about here? A guy, the pick of that lady and cries in his shoes?
This girl posted on Twitter. She posted these four pictures that she met. She met players outside the.
She's begging.
She wasn't begging. She got her pictures, and Kreider is
Patty.
Let's just say he needs Tommy with his shine box.
Well, shoes are all scuffed up.
Yeah, a little, you know. Not maybe exactly. Maybe there was lucky shoes. I don't know, but they're not the shoes you'd want to see. You know, a guy who makes $10 million wearing.
Oh, okay.
Let me see if I could bring this to the forefront real quick. I'll show you. But yeah, this girl met a couple of the players and the biggies too. Not just the, you know.
You saying that Rod is humble? Hey, he better be humble. He's making $10 million a year. He should be in the greatest mood of his life. Oh, Alec with a nice. He drags his feet off the ice, too. Ah, come on. That guy got 52 goals. Oh, my God.
I got Trent shoes that look better than that, right?
Buster Brown special. he seems like a really nice guy.
Man, look, I mean, those shoes are worn through. Look at the fronts of them.
Very frugal. It's okay. You can be frugal.
By the way, this is hard hitting. This is hard hitting analysis you will not get on any other show.
Yes. Looking at player's shoes. Is that the style that kind of at the end there? More than scuff? I don't like those shoes, man. I don't like shoes in general.
I'm not a brown shoes kind of guy, but.
Favorite shoes.
Look better than that, I could tell you that. I probably paid a lot less for them than he paid for his.
I think those are some Marshalls or regulars there.
Favorite. Little pair of Kinneys.
Yeah, really. He should have like a shoe rider in his contract.
Like a shoe rider?
A shoe rider. Yeah, very good. Very good.
Like I said, maybe those are his lucky shoes.
Maybe. My shoes.
My shoes. So, perfect shoes for a quiet night at Central Park.
Oh, man. That would have been bad. So, I liked everything. What I saw, Rangers, like you said, they really weren't into what's going to happen tomorrow. I got no idea, but I think the Rangers are going to win.
And let's get it done tomorrow night. We're going to let you guys go get on with your holiday weekend. I'm sure you got barbecues to go to. Jen and I are going to go out and get a couple 2-3 drinks.
Nice.
And,
where I'm headed.
We will see you here Tuesday night. If the Rangers are moving on, and if not, we will see you on YouTube. And if the Rangers are, either way, we'll have a lot to talk about Tuesday night. So,
all right, let's go Rangers. We're going to do this, and
let's go Rangers.
I'm very psyched, and I and you know what? I'm going to say it. If when we face the Tampa Bay Lightning, I think it'll be a lot closer than a lot of people are thinking around the NHL. Because I think the perception to just close it up is that the Rangers are very lucky. That they get outshot every game, but they win on Shesterkin's back. But they really don't. The Rangers get timely goals. They get big goals, which is not, at least at home, they get big goals.
Right.
Okay. And they're able to put 4 or 5. I don't think Carolina is, without a lot of luck and a lot of guys that you don't expect, can put 3 or 4 against Shesterkin. I think he's going to lock it down Monday. He's going to lock it down.
So. We'll see.
Tell Willie we ain't ready yet. What?
Tell Willie we ain't ready yet.
Maybe I should show up to the viewing party and announce the game for everybody.
Bring the megaphone.
Bring the megaphone. Sir. Yeah, come on, boys. Let's do it, girls. Let's do it. Let's go. I love you all, too.
All right. Enjoy the rest of your weekend. Let's go, Rangers. Let's get it done tomorrow night. We'll see you Tuesday, hopefully here at Patreon. We love you guys. Thanks for your support. Good night, everybody.
Good night.